Hi. Hi, Jacqueline. Hi, David. How's it going? Hello. Hi, Cheryl. Galen, Stacy, Wet. Hi, Melissa, Tara, Monique, Jeanette, Brenda. Wow, a lot of you guys are in here today. You're really on time. I love that. London, Rachel, Nyla. Hi there. Hey, everyone. Love this. Love this. Now, you might hear the lawn being mowed outside. So just ignore that. We've got a great conversation today. Hi, guys. Hi, Michael. Osama. Anthony, hi. Morris, hello, hello, hello. So we got a great conversation coming up today. I am about to interview Christine Simmons. She is the Chief Operating Officer of the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences, the Oscars. Incredible woman. And she is going to be talking today about the new rules that the Academy just announced. Starting the, oh, that's my alarm start. The new rules the Academy just announced to for the eligibility requirements for Best Picture, causing a lot of buzz in the industry. So, we are going to be talking about how this is going to affect what you see when you go to the movies, whenever we go to the movies, or when you are streaming movies that are eligible for Best Picture, and how it'll affect what we see, and how it is going to really change the industry. Very excited to be talking to Christine about that. Let's see. Is she in here yet? See, waiting for her to come on. I think it says supposed to tell me that somebody is waiting. Where's my waiting room? Okay, hi, Gilberto. Oh, I think I see her. Ah, okay. All right, I think she's here. I think she's here. Okay, so everybody, this is gonna be a great conversation today. So I am now going to bring in Christine Simmons, the Chief Operating Officer of the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences. So wait a minute, guys. You all know I have to put on my glasses when I do this. Okay. There we go. Hey, Christine.
Hey,
How are
Sean.
you?
I am wonderful. How are you?
I am doing fantastic, my friend. I miss you terribly. Full disclosure, everyone, Christine is a friend of mine, and she was kind enough to jump on this call today, this interview today, to talk about this huge news that the Academy, but I can't
Yeah.
wait to give you a hug in person
I
again
know. I
one day soon. But
know.
here we go.
Yes. Yes.
So let's talk about this. I mean, this is a huge announcement from the Academy. So I'd like for you to take me through the how it happened. I think we know why, but we're going to talk about that also.
Sure,
But you
sure.
know, what were the steps that led up to this huge announcement yesterday?
Yeah, and thanks, Sean. It's great to see you as always. The Academy has been at this for a little while, and we had our initial initiative called A2020, and that started long before I had the honor of working here. But and that was to double the number of women and people in underrepresented racial and ethnic communities by 2020 in our membership base, and our members are the ones that vote on these amazing films. And so those types of initiatives, as well as representation on our board of governors and some of our leadership committees, all of that had already begun. And so we had already begun to, okay, what's the next phase of that? We met that goal. In some places, we actually exceeded that goal, but knew there was a lot more work still to be done, even though that was an amazing accomplishment. And so, of course, the murder of George Floyd and all of the other manifestations of social inequity came about in our world. And so the Academy really stepped up and leaned in, and I couldn't be more proud. Our board of governors, led by David Rubin, our CEO, Don Hudson, just so many folks have really worked to figure out, okay, how can we celebrate all film? How mm-hmm. can we find a broader definition of excellence? And so that's how we came up with Aperture 2025. Mm-hmm. We want to broaden the lens by which we celebrate excellence and recognize it and see representation. And so that's how it started. Aperture 2025, we initially announced that a while ago. It's a 10-point program, or not even a program. It's a new way of how we're going to work. Mm-hmm. And it's all encompassing. And in that, one of those points was the creation of a task force in order to create these inclusion standards. And our brothers and sisters at BAFTA and BFI had instituted something like this many years ago, and we're grateful for the work that they did. Several other organizations have been at this as well. So we looked at all of those things. We've been picking their brains, the PGA, everybody, to say, okay, mm-hmm. what can work? What can make sustainable change so that all filmmakers' voices could be heard? That's what it's about. It's about mm-hmm. how many stories can we tell? And so these inclusion standards around our Best Picture nomination is our first step, or one of our steps, I should say. And believe me, it is this holistic approach mm-hmm. to how we're slowly making sure there's representation both in front of and behind the camera.
Okay, let's talk about some of the rules, and you can sure. and jump in here anytime. But what you have to do is meet 2 of 4 standards.
Yes.
On-screen representation, themes and narratives.
Yeah.
Creative leadership, project team. Mm-hmm. Industry access and opportunities, and audience development.
Yes.
What does that mean for sure. the audience
yeah.
looking
yeah.
at the films?
Right.
What do we see that's different? And what is happening behind the scenes that is different?
Exactly. So you may see difference in front of the camera, right? You ideally, you'll see more representation of what our world actually looks like, right? And no assumptions made about any roles or any characters. It actually is even more freeing for our filmmakers and our artists mm-hmm. to say there are no limitations to who can play what role. And let's open up our minds to think about things differently. So in front of the camera, the goal is to see more representation in that regard. The behind the camera, which many people won't see, is so important. There are so many careers. There's thousands of careers in film, you know, in entertainment, right? And so many of those decisions that are made behind the scenes will affect what you see in front of the camera, right? Is something represented well? Does the sound work? Does the writing work for that particular storyline? And depending on what story you're telling, it's important to have diverse voices helping to tell those stories so that they can be authentic and received as the filmmaker intended them to tell that story. So the audience representation, you know, we often see when organizations are marketing their products and mm-hmm. services to different communities, we want to make sure that that's the most authentic voice possible and really being a leader in the industry. And then, of course, the pipeline. It's mm-hmm. so key, right? We know that there's amazing, talented artists and filmmakers out there now, but how do we continue to inspire more and more people to understand all the beautiful crafts and all the artistry that is there and that are opportunities for folks? So making sure that there's a paid apprenticeships, paid internships, mm-hmm. That folks are getting opportunities that historically they hadn't gotten in our industry. So you may see it. It may be as obvious as, you know, people from underrepresented racial and ethnic communities or the LGBTQ or, you know, people with cognitive disabilities and physical disabilities, women and gender. It may be that obvious. It may not. And the beauty is it's job creation, but it's story creation and inspiration, if you will. And what else could the Oscars be about but inspiration, right?
Right. You know, I covered the red carpet. I covered 16 Oscars yes. in my career.
Yes, we did. I was going to suggest that we dressed up in like our old Oscar yes. gowns for this, since we can't really right. get dressed up these days.
Yes. You know, and so I remember, so I started at Access Hollywood back in 1999. Okay. Yes. Started like in May. So like the first Oscars I covered, I think were in 2000. Yes. And I remember I was like one of the only little black faces on that red carpet. Okay.
Yes.
Yes. So things have changed so much today. I see all different faces and people on the carpet, and it's so wonderful. And two, the membership of the Academy has also changed over these years. And I remember just, you know, years ago, we started to hear about more diverse voices within the Oscars, within the Leadership Academy, within the Voting Academy. And so the thinking was that that was going to be, as we add more diverse voices, we see more diverse films. Okay. Yes. That was the thinking. Did that not work? Did it not work fast enough? Did it, because you had to say, you're not only now saying we are going to have changes within our own academy, but folks, if you want to be considered, you have to do this. This is not this is not an ask. This is a requirement. So, you know, tell me, did you think that that was going to be enough, having those diverse voices within the academy? And then you had said, we want to move a little faster.
Sure. You know, I think with all of the ways that we're looking at systemic oppression and exclusionary practices, right, we have to look at every aspect of it. Voting membership is key. It's so important. And that was the first step, right? The standards by which we see excellence is now the next step. Right? But remember, the academy is at kind of the apex or the end of someone's career. Sometimes when they've achieved all the credits and accolades one could have, or the Oscar itself. And so, you know, it's really important for us as a film community to come together to create all the aspects and break down all of the individual barriers. Because yes, we're continuing to work on that which we have control over. Membership is one. Our board of governors and our leaders. Leadership is another. These rules are another. We're doing unconscious bias training for all of those leadership groups as well. We are making sure we have a beautiful film library and film archive. We're making sure that our collections are diverse. As filmmakers of tomorrow go and do their research, they need to make sure that all of the historic references are there as well. And then going out and acquiring those collections, right? Even our museum, we want to make sure that it's telling all of the stories, as challenging as they may be, because we'll have to acknowledge our past, but at the same time, all the beauty that is our future. So it truly is holistic, and it was important for us to stand up and say, okay, look, people are going to look to us as leaders regardless. So let's stand in that. And it was such a beautiful collaborative discussion and effort. We talked with so many different constituencies around our film community, and we all came together as a unit to really advance this. So we have to look at all things, that which we're responsible for, that which we influence, and then most importantly, that which you see on screen.
Yeah. And you know, Christine, you knew it would be met with some criticism out there. People are saying, what a great idea. You know, there are some criticism.
Just a little.
Kirstie Alley, who says she's been a member of the Motion Picture Academy for 40 years, she called it dictatorial and anti-artist. So for people like that, what would you say?
What I would say is that it actually, as we talked about earlier, frees the artists even more to tell even more stories in different ways, and more artists telling those stories. It's saying, look at, we've only looked at these options. Look at all of this beauty in film that we have. So it is not meant to dictate anybody. We definitely created them with the filmmaker in mind. We wanted to make sure that we continue our mission of celebrating all film. And if all film isn't there, then you can't determine excellence in the holistic approach. So, and of course, we welcome passionate debate. We're artists, right? In this community, and that's what it's about. But we want to really, and that's why we chose the name Aperture, right? Broaden the lens of excellence. And that's all it is broadening that lens, not dictating whatsoever. And it's one category. And then moreover, it actually, you know, we've heard a lot about, you know, potential films that maybe people think would not have qualified. But again, if there are artists behind the scenes helping to produce these, right, and create them and direct them and write them and visual effects and hair and makeup and all of those amazing crafts behind the scenes, then, you know, we are, again, opening it up. It doesn't mean that just because I am a Black director, I have to make content that has a Black lead. It actually frees them even more, and vice versa. So we understand, we knew that there would be some challenges, but we really want to reassure the artists in our community that we love their expression and we want to continue it. In fact, we want to bolster it and we want to see more of it.
Well, okay, let me ask you about a timeline. This is for 2025, right? That's the goal. How has COVID, as we know, at one point, Hollywood came to a standstill. What are things looking like now? Can you give us an update on what is looking like? I know the Oscars have been pushed back a little now.
Just a little bit. Yeah. And, it is tough, right? It's COVID is a tough time in general in our world. There's so much pain and so much loss. And then, of course, in our industry, it's been so hard hit. So we want to make sure that we're thoughtful about it. The timeline, it'll actually go into effect 2024. The first 2 years will be just data collection. And so folks, there are no thresholds that have to be met. We just want to start looking at the data. What are people doing and what are their efforts and initiatives? It's a collaboration with the filmmakers and the studios in a conversation to say, okay, we're seeing a lot of this. What about some more of this? And here's some resources to help. And so by our 96th Oscars is when the thresholds will actually have to be met in order to be eligible. Again, that doesn't talk to anything about how people will vote on the film. It just means the eligibility is there and you have more to choose from.
Yes. Yes, yes. Okay. I cannot let you go without talking a little bit about you, my friend. Okay. I always sing Christine's praises because she's such a phenomenal, phenomenal woman. You're a graduate of UCLA.
Go Bruins.
Yeah. You are, Christine, one of how many Black female COOs in the country? Probably not many. I think I know both of you. Well, my friend, your friend, Rosalind Brewer of Starbucks, and you are really you have broken a glass ceiling, and I just would like to talk a little bit about your journey very briefly, and just getting to this position and what you hope to represent being.
Thank you, Shaun.
The Academy.
You are phenomenal right back, and you have been breaking barriers yourself for a long time and doing it with such brilliance and professionalism and grace, of course. But I think we always start with the grace and the poise, and we don't start with the brilliance and the talent. So kudos to you, my friend. And thank you for the kind words. It's funny because I've had such a non-traditional path getting here, but looking back, it all makes sense, right? And so it's always been strategy, business excellence, and results through with a thread and a through line of empowerment and advocacy and equity. And then my passions are sports and entertainment and business and finance. And I've always talked about changing trajectories, right? And I feel like those are the industries where we can change trajectories in meaningful ways to create a ripple effect and generational wealth and legacy and opportunity in ways that you can't necessarily do in other industries per se because of the visibility of the platform. So whether it was with my LA Sparks or before that with Disney or NBC Universal. And of course, my mentor and one of the key visionaries in the world, Magic Johnson, those have all been phenomenal opportunities where I've been able to get the opportunity, but then also showcase what we can do as brilliant women, as brilliant Black folk, but just as brilliant business people. And I think that's where we're all trying to get at the end of the day. At the end of the day, you want to just be the best at your job. I want to be the best at my job. Mm-hmm. But we also know that we have a little bit of ways to go before we can get there and some more ceilings to break. So I don't take it lightly. At the same time, you know me, I don't take myself that seriously. So I'm still Christine from Rancho Cucamonga and just really believe in servant leadership. And empowering those who are willing to contribute to this cause of doing well and doing good, as Irvin always says, right? So that's me, just here trying to leave it better than how we found it.
And you are doing just that, my friend. You are just so phenomenal and such a incredible representation of all women. And we all aspire to be role models for our younger girls. And I know that you do a lot of work in that area. And when you have time, I know that you are really busy right now, but when you have time, you have to come back on, because I really do want to do a journey throughout your life and lessons that you have learned along the way, and give us all some inspiration about reaching higher and being the best we can be.
So, I would love that. I would love that. Thank you, Shaun. And I just, one last note, I just want to just commend our board, yes, and their leadership, and then all of the tireless. There's so many folks on our team at the Academy who have worked so tirelessly on this. It truly is a village, and yeah, we are all in this together, this bigger ecosystem of what we're doing. So us at the Academy, our board, our colleagues within the industry, we're all coming together. And I know that we can really move forward in this mission of celebrating film and its legacy. And we just got to broaden that aperture. So I look forward to coming back and talking some more with you.
Yeah, and when you talked about, and because, you know, we are all about the job creation, the many people who have felt excluded, yeah, from the industry or could not even get in the door, could not get a seat at the table. And really, I think at the end of the day, that is what it is about, making sure that everybody has the opportunity to at least be seen, you know,
yes,
and to,
yes,
believe that they do have a chance, do have a shot at, yes, an Academy Award. I mean, as being COO, as being, an, you know, an entertainment host. It's all about having opportunity, the access to opportunity. That's really the bottom line.
That's so, what it's about. Absolutely. Well said.
All right. Thank you, my friend. You have a
Thank
wonderful
you.
Day. I love you so much. And
love you right back.
You. Okay.
Okay.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Okay, everybody. Wasn't she amazing? Wasn't she phenomenal? Christine Simmons, COO of the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences. Okay, everybody. I hope you enjoyed that conversation. Hope you enjoyed it. Let's see. You guys saying okay, thank you, making a way, love, ba-da-da. Okay, just sending all your love. Thank you. Okay, guys. I think let me see. Okay. Okay, guys, have a good one. I'll see you later. Bye.